program, New York State does not have a permanent program of providing emergency assistance to farmers when milk prices drop dangerously low like they are. Maybe we should take a look at what Connecticut has with a dairy relief program, Massachusetts Dairy Farm Credit Tax Program, Maine Dairy Stabilization Program, New Hampshire Milk Producers Emergency Relief Fund. Other food for thought: should New York establish a permanent targeted emergency relief program for dairy farmers when their milk prices fall below a certain threshold, which does not accommodate cost of production? Or number two, what type of emergency vehicle would best accomplish this? Emergency dairy relief fund, refundable reinvestment, tax credit, or another option? In summation, as we discussed, the marketplace is currently creating a supply management that a year from now, when consumers go to the store and there is limited amounts of milk that they're able to buy, or there is no milk available after a certain time of day, the consumers will recognize this as well. I believe that this is almost inevitable outcome at this point. Many cows have been culled for production reasons across the country. Unprecedented economic stress that the dairy farmer has faced will result in loss of production. With these living organisms, when too many corners are cut, eventually it catches up with you, and those effects will be seen over the next year. I also believe that as when the price rises, the demand for cows increases, driving livestock prices up, and then we'll start to see many tired dairy farmers getting out of the business. Unfortunately, even though the price of cattle will go up, it seems unlikely that it will increase to levels seen a year ago because of the financial stress on potential purchasers and their lending institution. Of course, state government is limited in their ability to impact some of these broader issues, but I would like to see that New York maintains their farmer-friendly programs. When the state is in dire financial condition, there will be certain pressures to eliminate programs like farmers' school tax refund, assessment programs on ag districts. I want to see you stress the importance of these programs and how that we would be much worse off to abandon these programs. I want to point that out now. Overall, I view New York as very farm friendly. State officials are very responsible. You've acted very responsible, and I thank you for protecting our interest. And that's my comment.
Thank you, Mr. Prescott. So you believe that if we pass the dairy assistance program now, that would help the farmers through this crisis, and then we have to look at longer-term solutions?
We certainly do, and I hope if nothing else comes out of this meeting today that we can look at some of those long-range programs. Obviously, I mentioned Farm Bureau. I think Farm Bureau is recognized at the state level. We're a grassroots organization. I know Julie and other people speak after me, but I think that's where it starts, and anything you can do will help. Everyone's alluded to the fact that farmers are having a tough time paying their bills, and I think I've used my own farm as an example of the twofold problem, and I don't want to see people hanging from the rafters.
Thank you.
It's that serious.
Mr. Kreskut, thank you. You were very enlightening. You know, you're the fourth of four farmers that have spoken so far. And a constant theme that I'm hearing, special interest, manipulation, not a good pricing system for milk in the Northeast. I'm just going to ask you a worst-case scenario question. Let's assume the trend continues where there's not long-term solutions. Do you envision our farms being lost across the country, and will it affect our ability to feed our country domestically?
It certainly will.
And it will eventually lead to more foreign imports?
It certainly will.
Do you see this as a trend?
Yes, I see it as a trend unless we can turn it around. And they've also need to work on a federal level, as I said, with milk protein concentrates, and making sure the quality of the product coming into this country is the same quality produced by the same standards that our dairy farmers presently do. I cannot think of a product produced in this nation that is under as many regulations and quality issues as New York State milk, or for that matter, milk across the nation. We are definitely controlled. That when that milk is on the truck, you're pretty certain it's a good quality product.
I remember a couple of years ago we were looking into agro-terrorism in terms of food coming in from foreign sources. I'm not being a dramatist here, but
right.
My point is the trend that I would want to see is that we keep our farmers healthy here, we grow our own product here, and ensures our food supply and ensures the quality of our food supply for America.
Thank you, and I believe there's a lot more chance of terrorist activity with food coming into our country.
Right.
They mentioned terrorist activity on local dairy farms. I think that may come down to irate help, something to that effect. I don't think there's a concern in locally for the terroristic action among our dairy farmers. Because they would shoot first and ask questions later.
Thank you, Mr. Kreskin. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You have a question?
Yes, Senator Seward.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Crosscut. You're a gentleman that really likes challenges, 40 years in the dairy industry.
And, I love it.
And the local government as well, so you like your challenges.
Bear in mind, my wife's a school teacher, so that helped me survive.
You made many excellent points. I was struck with really two points that you raised, and Mr. Myers, before you did the same, in terms of the, we're really talking about an economic issue that goes way beyond the dairy farm here.
Sir.
There are plenty of people talk about the upstate economy, but it's always been my belief that if agriculture, and particularly dairying, was doing well, the upstate economy would be doing a heck of a lot better than it is today. So we're really intertwined.
Yes, we are.
No question about it. And secondly, you talked about the consumer interest here, and I don't think we have done a good enough job, I say we collectively, all of us who are sympathetic to the dairy farmers' plight and the dairy farmers themselves, in terms of generating support and interest among the consumer groups of our state, because it strikes me that the consumer has a great deal at stake here as well. If at the end of the day they have their dairy products are either in the hands of a very few large corporations in this country or a heavier dependence on foreign imports, that's not in the best interest of the consumer, it seems to me, from many, many aspects of price as well as the safety and security issues that we've talked about. So going forward, I think there's a great untapped support block out there that is among our the consumers of dairy products who are really have a great deal at stake here, as do our dairy farmers and our entire economy.
Thank you, and I cannot praise you enough. I believe in New York State milk, apples, and good lean beef, any agriculture product that you can do to protect our borders and be grown locally by New York State producers. I compliment you for that. And as far as I'm concerned, you've been working towards that, and you're doing as much as you can. But thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks. That was very good. That was excellent. Okay.
Our next speaker is Mr. Thomas Slate, Executive Director of the New York State Farm Viability Institute, and he's being joined by Mark Kenville, who is the Director of the New York State Center for Dairy Excellence. Welcome, gentlemen.
Senator Young, for the invitation to appear before you today. Senator, you've been a consistent supporter of the missions of the New York Farm Viability Institute and New York Center for Dairy Excellence, and we appreciate the leadership you provide on behalf of New York farmers. Today's excellent panel of speakers provides a very broad spectrum of expertise and solutions. And I'll focus my remarks today on what the New York Farm Viability Institute is dedicated to, and that is engaging and empowering farmers themselves to find common solutions. More on the technical and managerial side You know, we don't deal much in policy. There's many other speakers will be speaking to that quite aptly. As a point of reference, let me share just a slice of my background and how that may relate to today's discussion. I was born and raised and worked as a partner on our family's dairy farm in Dutchess County. While clearly dating myself, during the mid-1970s, economic and infrastructure realities spelled the end of our family's dairy farm after 8 generations on the same farm. Staying in agriculture but leaving the Northeast, I spent the next 25 years of my career working with a wide variety of farmers and commodities, from western U.S. wheat and barley producers to midwestern corn and soybean producers to southern U.S. specialty crop producers. I've seen the ebbs and flows of supply and demand for U.S. crops and a variety of programs to deal with an ever-changing, very competitive global market for food and agricultural products. The crisis facing the dairy industry, while severe, is unfortunately not unprecedented in U.S. agriculture, and a common theme to the solutions that I've seen in the past is just what this and many other recent dairy forums and meetings have focused on, namely getting farmers to work together as farmers and to work together with agribusiness, academia, and government to find solutions in a very complex agricultural economy. From the New York Farm Viability Institute's perspective, we focus on the first element, engaging farmers to decide their own future. New York Farm Viability Institute is a unique organization. Farmers are at the forefront of decision making. Farmers prioritize areas of research needed, review project proposals, and determine how limited dollars are invested. In 2008, 175 farmer volunteers assisted the Institute in this process, and each project is guided by a singular mission, developing models for other farms to follow and increasing their own profits. Since 2006, the United New York Farm Viability Institute has funded 65 projects focused on the New York dairy industry. Yes, there should be a strong focus on policy development, short-term economic decisions in dealing with the current crisis facing the New York dairy industry, but from our perspective, we must combine these solutions with a strong continuing focus on innovation, management, and technical expertise to keep New York dairy farmers competitive locally, regionally, nationally, and or globally. If I separate New York Farm Viability Institute projects into 5 general categories, they would be, first, expanding the use of existing and new production technology. Second, value-added product development and creating market segmentation. And third, fourth, and fifth, management, management, and management. We have 2 examples I'd like to cite in terms of production technology innovation. A compost dairy barn facility in western New York. Cow comfort, nutrient management, and animal health are all top concerns for New York dairies. The recently completed New York Farm Viability Project analyzing cow housing and bedding alternatives yielded surprisingly strong results in adding to farm profitability. The product analyzed a newly developed system of using composted bedding materials in a housing system that led to a decline in lameness in cattle from 23% to 3.4%. That translated into a $33,000 increase in net revenue over the course of the year. Milk quality was maintained under the new system, and the project manifested significant environmental benefits from a decrease in volatilized ammonia and decreased odor, and substantial benefits and cost savings from utilizing composted materials as fertilizer. A pasteurized waste milk project. This grant was awarded in 2005 to a veterinarian in western New York. Assistance of $15,000 helped 8 farmers evaluate cost savings in feeding calves pasteurized milk from treated cows and cows that recently gave birth, milk that usually gets thrown out. A farm that was spending $100 per day to feed 90 calves powdered milk replacer is now spending $17 a day to run a pasteurizer, a savings of more than $30,000 a year. One classic problem U.S. agriculture has faced continually over the past few decades is that farmers are really good at creating perfect competition. Everyone produces a substantial volumes of essentially the same product, be that grain, soybeans, or milk. Over the past 5 to 10 years, however, innovative producers have broken this pattern by identifying and developing value-added products and niche markets. For dairy, a particularly cogent example was the Evans Farmhouse Creamery. Through a New York Farm Viability Institute grant to look at value-added dairy products and collaborative marketing, the Evans are now producing local organic and non-organic milk, or processing local and organic non-organic milk for clients who make dairy value-added products. They make their own cheese, milk, cream, butter, and yogurt. Each of these tasks independently would not make enough money for the business to be successful. The Evans found a balance between co-packing and processing that is very productive, profitable, and successful. The Evans purchased milk from local farms and charged no hauling charge. They pay a dependable high dollar for the milk that comes from these farms. The Evans pay $20 to $25 for conventional milk with no additional hauling costs, and $30 to $32 for organic milk with no additional hauling costs. Currently, Evans buy milk from 9 dairies, 5 conventional and 4 organic. Plans are being devised to increase from 9 dairies to approximately 20 dairies in the next year. Conventional and organic dairy farmers can continue to farm while making money and continue to sell into the local food economy, and they depend on the Evans to continue paying top dollar for their milk. By selling to Evans, farmers do not have to worry about the fluctuating milk price and do not have to pay hauling. Through marketing assistance provided through this grant, the Evans Farmhouse currently landed a successful, dependable tenant account with Siggy's Yogurt, using the incoming milk from local dairies, processing and packing Siggy's Yogurt, and selling the excess cream to City Bakery in New York City, and realizing the potential that Siggy Yogurt has in new markets all contribute to the success of Evans Farmhouse Creamery. Now, granted, this is a one particular enterprise, and it is a niche market, and it's a saying in the agricultural marketing, niche markets feel fast. But it's an example of a farm looking at different type of operations. Before I move on to the final categories of management, I also like to take a look briefly at New York farm viability projects that go beyond having a dairy-specific focus. Farm Viability Institute currently has 100 active projects that represent the broad spectrum of New York agriculture. Farm viability projects adjust the diversity of New York agriculture in terms of commodity mix, from cabbage to castor beans, from geography. There are farm viability projects all across the state, from size, from small farms to large farm, and production practices, from conventional, organic, low input, et cetera. While it may not be entirely a positive message, farmers realize that sometimes they must move on to other enterprises. Two of our board members are former dairy farmers themselves and have transitioned into other crops and enterprises. Keeping innovation and entrepreneurism alive and thriving across all sectors of New York agriculture will better define alternatives for farmers to evaluate. Just last week, I had a conversation with a farmer from Western New York who is an aggressive partner in a farm viability project evaluating different crop and technology options for bioenergy development. He said to me rather passionately that we just have to find something else for farmers to grow profitably. Another key element for Ellen to focus on are solutions for dairy farms is farm transition, and New York Farm Viability is hard at work funding New York FarmNet programs that directly consult with individual farmers on enterprise management, enterprise transition, and farm transfer. And they're also looking through the New York Farm Viability funding, developing a manual for these different practices. Finally, let me segue into management. Senator Young, I'm sure you recall the rather poignant gathering of over 200 farmers and agribusiness representatives in Cobeskill back in the winter of 2007, our last struggle with the low price cycle. The vision of the Institute's all-farmer board of directors back in December of 2006 is the same as it is today. We need to help farmers with the managerial tools and strategies to cope with the downturn in prices and how to recover from, more quickly, a downturn in price. In 2007, the legislature made two key investments for the future of New York dairy industry through the Dairy Assistance Program and by supporting the creation of the New York Center for Dairy Excellence. The Center for Dairy Excellence is an initiative of the New York Farm Viability Institute designed to increase New York's dairy farm profitability and build a stronger dairy industry in the Northeast. At the core of this effort was the goal to implement programs designed to increase the overall level of professionalism of dairy farms, regardless of their size and production practices. In 2007, 5 projects were initiated under the Center for Dairy Excellence, and they were agri-service profit-focused discussion groups, Dairy Profit Team Pilot Program, Manure Management Technology Program, Herdsman Skills Enhancement Modules. And the fifth was to hire someone whose sole job description is to come into work each morning focusing entirely and solely on dairy and coordinating various diverse elements of the New York State dairy industry. To do continued discussion on dairy management and update you on how the New York Center for Dairy Excellence is focused on the short and longer term solutions for this dairy crisis, I would like to, unless there are specific questions for me, turn the podium over to Mark Kendall, the director for the New York Center for Dairy Excellence. And thanks again for the opportunity to testify before you today.
Thank you, Mr. Slay. I think what we'll do is move on to Mr. Kenville, and then if we have questions at the end, we can ask either of you. How's that?
Great.
Great.
Good morning. Thank you, Senator Young, for the invitation to be here and help put a spotlight on the current financial hardship that our dairy farmers are facing. While those of us who are involved in the dairy industry are very aware of the situation, it is essential that people who are far removed from agriculture and food production understand the economic stress being experienced by our dairy farmers. As a nation, we take for granted the safe, abundant, affordable food supply. Public forums such as these are commendable for initiating dialogue with broader audiences on dairy issues and shoring up support to address them. I am the director of the New York Center for Dairy Excellence, a position I have held for a little more than 2 years. As Tom Slate has already noted, the genesis of the center emerged from a public hearing in 2006 when dairy farmers were being challenged by another cycle of severe low milk prices. The center was formed to promote collaboration among dairy industry stakeholders to bring resources to dairy farmers to improve productivity, profitability, and enrich their quality of life. We are dairy farmer focused and farmer driven and exclusively work on making a significant impact at the farm level. While other organizations serve dairy farmers by being public policy advocates, our efforts continue to be focused on developing programs that address managerial and operational aspects of milk production. Let me take this time to express our gratitude to the state legislature and the Department of Ag and Markets for providing the Center for Dairy Excellence with funding for our programs over the past few years. The Center for Dairy Excellence, guided by a task force comprised of dairy farmers, agribusiness professionals, educators, government officials, researchers, and industry organization representatives, has been able to implement several programs that impact farm management. We have advanced a program creating dairy farmer profit discussion groups across the state. These discussion groups give dairy farmers the opportunity to test and exchange ideas with others who face and solve similar challenges. Oftentimes, farmers learn best from drawing from the knowledge of other farmers. Currently, with support from the center, there are more than 440 discussion groups active in the state, being attended by 500 farmers. These groups, facilitated by local agribusiness professionals, represent more than one-third of the state's dairy cows. Each group is formed around a particular area of interest and range from very specific focuses, like calf raising, crop production, or use of robotics, to broader interests and commonalities such as grazing in organic dairies, young farm managers, women in dairying, and farms dealing with intergenerational transitions. These groups are self-directed, but all have established their value as an informational and managerial resource and by establishing a network of peer support. This past June, the center launched a statewide dairy profit team program, expanding upon the success of three profit team pilot projects that were funded by the New York Farm Viability Institute. A dairy profit team is a farm management resource that utilizes a coordinated group approach in assisting farmers with evaluating their dairy operations and identifying areas to improve performance and profits. This team of advisors meets regularly to help a farmer work through defined issues and opportunities on the farm, develop strategies for change, and provide input for decision making and longer term strategic planning. Teams often include veterinarians, animal nutritionists, agronomists, lenders, reproduction specialists, cooperative extension personnel, among others. The Center for Dairy Excellence administers the program, trains facilitators for the teams, as well as provides cost-share funding to help farmers set up their teams. Within 2 months of announcing the new statewide program, we accepted farm applications to start 45 new teams, which was our limit based on available funding. Today, we have a waiting list for this program. Along with the pilot farms from the New York Farm Viability Institute project, more than 70 teams are now operational in the state. And last winter, as dairy farmers were bracing for this cycle of plummeting milk prices and high input costs, one farmer told our task force that he felt he was in a much better position to face the impending dairy crisis, knowing his profit team was in place and would be working with him on making important decisions affecting the future of his operation. In addressing more specialized aspects of operating a dairy, the center was a major supporter and funder of a herdsman skills training curriculum, which started in Wyoming County and is now being replicated in three other regions of the state. These training modules for farm workers focus on specific critical tasks such as producing high-quality milk, labor efficiency, breeding, calf care, and herd health. In addition to the knowledge gained, participants in the program can obtain continuing education credits as well as credits through the SUNY system. In the initial course offerings in Wyoming County, 115 farm workers participated in the modules, representing 43 farms from 11 different counties in the western part of the state. We anticipate the replications that have just begun this fall in three other regions of New York will have equal success. This winter, the center will be launching a dairy risk management educational initiative. The Farm Viability Institute has allocated funding for a multi-tiered approach to deliver information to dairy producers on risk management tools and how they might be utilized to reduce milk price volatility. We are collaborating with the Department of Agriculture and Markets, the region's cooperatives and lenders, and extension personnel to deliver this much-needed educational program. Up front, let me say I am not an expert in dairy economics or policy analysis. There are more authoritative speakers here today to address how we got to where we are and what the potential solutions are to avert future financial crises caused by low milk prices. In addition to my position with the Center for Dairy Excellence, I also serve as New York's administrative representative to the NEDLT, the Northeast Dairy Leadership Team. The NEDLT was formed in 2006 through a memorandum of understanding signed by the New York State Commissioner of Agriculture and Markets and the Secretaries of Agriculture from Pennsylvania and Vermont, with a common vision for promoting a vibrant, growing, and profitable dairy industry in the Northeast. The NEDLT is comprised of more than 50 individuals representing all facets of the dairy industry in the region, including dairy farmers, processors and manufacturers, and representatives from co-ops, allied support industries, universities, dairy promotion groups, and state departments of agriculture. Just last Wednesday, the NEDLT met in Syracuse to discuss the dairy crisis and to begin developing recommendations for change. From that meeting, points of agreement included support for expanding the current CWT program, cooperatives working together, developing alternatives to the CME for price discovery, improving NAS survey timeliness, exploring potential changes to the federal milk marketing order system, supporting multiple-year pricing contracts, developing producer income insurance programs, and improving risk management tools. The NEDLT will further define its recommendations in the coming weeks and develop a strategy for advancing these ideas. Again, I'd like to thank you, Senator Young, for inviting me to be a participant in this very crucial discussion on the future of the dairy industry. The Center for Dairy Excellence is prepared to build on the momentum it has gained and continue providing managerial and operational resources that will have a positive impact on the state's dairy farmers now and in the future.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Kendall, on your last point with the Northeast Dairy Leadership Team, I'm very interested in that because I know that the northeastern states, the handful that have gotten together, have been meeting for a few years. So it's good to hear that they're starting to come up with policy recommendations. Fred Crosscut talked about the fact that Farm Bureau may want to resurrect the Northeast Dairy Compact. The problem with that is that we remember this very well in 1998, that the state had to fight to get into it, but now it's been dissolved on the federal level. So we almost have to be forced to come up with our own initiatives to deal with this because we can't get any kind of assistance from the feds. And I'm glad that they have come up with some solutions because I believe that we need to look at this on a northeastern regional basis because we can price ourselves out of the market in New York State if we're not careful. And obviously we need to be looking at this in a wider scale. So I would love to get, you're going to give us a copy of your testimony, but those last points were very good points, and I think they need to be part of the longer-term solution that we're seeking.
And the NEDLT is further broadening its position on those, and there will be an official recommendation from the NEDLT coming out shortly.
Thank you. Thanks. Okay. Great. Our next speaker is Bruce Krupke from Northeast Dairy Foods Association. He's Executive Vice President in Syracuse. Thank you. not going to read all that, right?
Pardon me?
You're not going to read all that, right?
Yes, no, no. I promise. No, okay, this is just that's just reference information and some notes. Good morning, Senator Young.
Thank you.
Senator Seward and Senator Bonacic. Nice to see all of you here today. And thank you for having me here as part of this discussion. My name is Bruce Krupke, and I'm the Executive Vice President for the Northeast Dairy Foods Association. And we are a trade association that's made up of customers of dairy farmers. We represent the processors, manufacturers, and distributors who buy raw milk from dairy producers, either independently or through cooperatives, doing business here in New York State. And our association's been in existence since 1928. And just to give you some information, I'm here for three reasons at your invitation. I'd like to quickly discuss support for a bill that you sponsored. I'd like to provide you with a little unique perspective as customers of dairy producers. And I would also like to provide you with some alternative concepts and ideas to consider to assist the dairy producers and the dairy industry here in New York State. For reference, there's 106 dairy plants, processing plants, here in the state. There are about 600 licensed distributors, 300 of which distribute fluid milk, the others remaining products like ice cream, cheese, and yogurt, doing business here in the state that's licensed by our Department of Agriculture. We're a big part of the dairy industry. We are known as the middle person, and we sell to wholesale accounts, other distributors, food service locations, as you can expect, supermarkets, retailers, restaurants, and so on. My main reason for being here today at your invitation is to support Senate Bill 06140, your call for emergency dairy assistance, similar to what you helped with the dairy producing community in 2006. Our association is in full support of that legislation. We're very curious as to why other legislators haven't supported your initiative, specifically the leadership in the Senate and on the agriculture community. We supported the initiative back in 2006, and we supported it again this year, and I'll explain why and why it's important. And we're calling on the Patterson administration, other legislators, and the Ag Department to act promptly and quickly to assist with this emergency assistance. If you take a look at agriculture markets law, and you look back through history, consistently, ag markets law and New York State citizens and taxpayers have set as a major priority the agriculture community and the dairy industry in our state. We've seen it through all kinds of legislation. It's heavily regulated, but they set it as a preeminence. In our economy here in New York State, the agriculture industry and the dairy industry are very, very important. So what we need to do as citizens, as organizations, as legislators, and the administration is to take a hard look right now at this legislation that you're supporting and move quickly to provide that assistance to our dairy farmers and producers here in the state. And the theory is very simple. The reason that this assistance is needed and it's fair is that it's shared by all taxpayers. Other programs or initiatives could unduly impact milk consumers or dairy product consumers. If the state holds highly the importance of the agriculture industry here in our state and the dairy industry, more importantly, then it stands to reason that the entire state's economy should share in support of the dairy producers at this very tough time that they're experiencing. So that is why our association, our members, and our board of directors support you wholeheartedly in passing and getting support for Senate Bill S06140 that will provide emergency assistance to dairy producers. Now, in my job, I have a unique position. Our association is a Northeast association. A year ago, we expanded from New York to all of New England, New York, and New Jersey. We now encompass eight states. I've had the opportunity over the past 12 months to travel to many of these states. Maine, just last Friday, in New Jersey, Vermont, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Connecticut. And what we're seeing is this is a similar situation that's shared by all the dairy producers, not only in the Northeast, but throughout the country, as you know. What I'm hearing, what I'm seeing, is that there's a call for something to be done. And in my position, I can see the big macro picture. And as you can understand, there's the micro picture of here, what's happening in New York State, is what you can do or you can't do, and also what should be done on a national basis. I contend that your hands are tied somewhat. This is a national problem. The result of the current situation in the federal water system has to be handled, has to be controlled, and is controlled by the dairy producers in our country. They do have the power, they do have the authority to control the situation that's happening here in the United States. And we call on the dairy producers, the cooperatives, the organizations that dairy producers and farmers belong to come together to find a consensus to their policies and proceed in looking at federal water reform and those changes that are needed. Finally, alternatives. You've heard already from some speakers, and you'll hear from a few more, as to what you can or you cannot do. There are both long and short-term solutions. We take a look at this situation as there's a term that was used this past week at the Dairy Lee Annual Cooperative meeting in Syracuse, that the industry needs to either go global or they need to go Canadian. And what that really means is that we either need to have an open market and be able to market our products globally, or we need to close our borders and adopt a system such as Canada. And this is the struggle that the industry is going through right now, to be global or to close our borders. And within that decision, then will come the policies and all the effort that's needed so that producers can get what they consider their fair share, the middle person, the customers of dairy producers, can find their fair share, and consumers can benefit from a strong dairy industry here in the state. Taking a look at what Tom Slate and Mark Henville just provided you with is a strong indicator of action, long-term action, that the state can continue to support. 10 years ago, I was a member of Governor George Pataki's New York State Dairy Task Force, and we provided the governor with this thick book, and it's still out there. A lot of suggestions were used, some haven't been, some succeeded, some failed. But in that document right there are a lot of good ideas that I encourage you to read and take a look at and see if you could resurrect some of those concepts. But the point is, 10 years ago we were talking about this, and 10 years prior to that we were talking about this. So those ideas are out there. I heard mention earlier of a successful program, another long-term program that the state could consider, that the state of South Carolina created, Massachusetts followed, and other states are considering, is an income tax credit based on the amount of milk that's produced. It's a strong program. It does not provide the necessary need for funds up front, and it takes a look at what happens on the farm after the year is over in the form of a tax credit. So it's a program that you could take a look at and consider. Other alternatives. One of the things that you may or may not hear here that I like to present to groups, legislators such as yourself, and this is one of the most important that we think is very important, is the need to increase sales. That's the problem within the industry. That's the problem that the reason that I consider that we're all here from my professional opinion. Because sales have declined fluid milk, sales have increased on class two and class three products. The blend price that dairy producers are receiving would be lower regardless of a recession, national or global recession, or other impacts or factors that impact the dairy industry. As legislators, any piece of legislation that comes across your desk or that has the word milk or dairy or ice cream in it, you need to take a close look at to find out what the impact is going to be on sales. We need to increase sales as a dairy industry. The farmers are doing a good job through their Got Milk program. Processors are doing a very good job with their milk mustache program. We need to promote, we need to advertise, we need to drink milk, we need to find ways that our state can support the industry by helping to increase sales. And I'll leave you with one curious example. All the time that I drive up and down the New York State Thruway, and I was just in New Jersey, and I went through Pennsylvania and stopped at one of their rest stops. If you take a look, you can't find New York ice cream anywhere on the New York State Thruway. Why is that? You'll see Edie's, you'll see Hershey's, you'll see Ben and Jerry's, but you won't see Perry's, you won't see Burn Dairy, you won't see Washburn's, you won't see Fieldbrook, you won't see Mercer's, All right? There's a lot of examples that I can provide you. For the sake of time, I won't go through them all today. I've outlined a few of them in my presentation here. But remember, and I encourage everyone in this audience to consider that we've lost sales. We need to increase sales. Increase sales, a lot of the problems that we're here today to talk about go away. And with that, that's all that I have today, is just a little bit of perspective as the customers of dairy producers. I'd like to just leave you with this one final thought, that what we need, and when you consider in doing anything as far as legislating or when it comes to a national program, is that as customers of dairy farmers, we're like customers like we all of are. We want to find the lowest price to be able to maximize our profits. And when we have that need in the marketplace, we need our dairy farmers to be competitive. If we have competitive dairy farmers, which I believe we do have here in New York State and the Northeast, our dairy farmers can compete with those in surrounding states, and they can compete easily with other parts of the country and especially in the world. If we adopt that attitude, I feel that we can all be winners, both producers, processors, and ultimately for the consumers. Those are my statements today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kupke. I want to thank you for your support of Senate Bill 6140. And as you know, we've been pushing to have the governor and the legislative houses do something immediately. And there are $26.7 billion in federal stimulus money through the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act that have been given to New York State. And I have a copy of the act right here in front of me. One of the provisions says that the purpose and principles, number one, to preserve and create jobs and promote economic recovery. Number two, to assist those most impacted by the recession. I believe that Senate Bill 6140 meets those top two criteria, and that's why we're calling on the governor, we're calling on the Senate majority and the Assembly majority to stand up and do something for the dairy farmers. You talked about volatility in the, or you talked about sales declining. What ideas do you have to increase sales? I agree that the Got Milk, the Milk Mustache programs are good. One of the issues that I believe is at hand is the fact that there's volatility on the shelves where you see milk prices or dairy products go way up and then go way down. The studies that I've seen have shown that that turns off the consumers. They get very angry when the prices go way up. And so what are some of your solutions to increase sales? Do you have any ideas on that?
There's a lot of ideas that we could discuss. The topic of volatility is one that's huge. You have a national and a global marketplace contributing to that volatility. And whether you view it as good or bad, some volatility is necessary. We're not going to be able to get away with it because there are supply and demand factors that we need. Consumers, my personal opinion is, I agree. I don't think consumers that are subjected to very high prices or very low prices, they get confused. Why is milk at this price, regardless of whether they shop at a warehouse outlet or they go to a high-end retailer? They're going to see a price difference, but within that structure of marketing, we see the volatility of the price swings at farm level. Sales of milk as a generic commodity product are very difficult. The trend is, when you go to a school district, is to bid it at the lowest price, at the cheapest package, at the least expensive ingredients. So why would a milk processor continue to put a good product out in the sense of packaging or labeling? There are very good examples of that. I have some over on the table over there if we needed to pull them out. But you take a look at the 16-ounce milk pint that a lot of the companies here in New York State have created to be more consumer-friendly. Within the industry, we're doing a lot. There's a lot of market research, a lot of consumer innovation that are out there within the processing industry. We're looking at what the consumer wants. That's just one example of what needs to be done to help increase sales. What can you as legislators do? Take a look at the thruway. Take a look at the bid systems for all of your institutions. How's it conducted? We went from independent bidding of all your state health and mental institutions and correctional facilities from each individual to having to have a region bid. That decreases competition. It decreases innovation. Within the state, promote milk yourselves. Have it at meetings like this. Talk about it. Encourage consumers. Put out press releases that the industry is important. As legislators, you need to be the leaders out there for the product. If you're doing that for us, that will help. It'll increase exposure and do what's necessary to get the message out to consumers. Within the industry, we're trying to do all that we can to increase milk sales. We're looking at supermarket shelves and how they're laid out. We're looking at space allocation. We're looking at profitability of all of the different individual products. We're working with retailers to maximize sales out of dairy cases. There's a lot happening out there, but our biggest problem is that we have competing beverages. There's more beverages. When I started in the industry 25 to 30 years ago, orange juice was not sold in the milk case, but it is now. We have competing beverages. We're paying money for bottled water. All right. When milk has the most nutrient content rich package out there. So we're doing the best that we can. We're trying hard with limited resources against the big money that's coming from our competition. But I encourage you to lead the charge through some of those ideas that I just presented to you.
Do you think we're the leading country in terms of the ability to feed itself, America?
I think if we're not, we're probably, you know, in the top two or three. I think the United States has one of the best food systems that I've seen. I deal with it a lot in terms of regulatory safety, packaging, labeling, nutrition. We certainly have the production ability. Within the milk industry, absolutely. We're stellar.
Do you think we have the ability in America to feed the world?
That's a big question. We have the ability to produce. What we don't have, and this is key, we need to be able to compete on the world marketplace. That's the key. Whether or not we have the food, it doesn't matter if we're not competing at a low efficient price. If New Zealand dairy farmers can produce milk cheaper than we can, they're going to get the business in China. They're going to get the business in South America. They're going to get the business in other countries that are importing products in the dairy industry. So we do, but we need to be competitive.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Typically, that's not.
Well, why don't you tell us what the question
yeah.
is? And
I'm here as a consumer. I'm not a dairy farmer. Yes. And I just want to clarify that when we see prices change, perhaps it causes confusion. But what causes absolute rage and absolute indignation is to come to time that the very people producing the product aren't getting any kind of profit passed through. And so as a consumer, my new wish more than anything from Santa Claus is the annual report from the processors to understand where the milk money is going. Because I live in New York City, I pay $3.69 for a gallon of milk, and come to find we're getting a dollar or less on the other end, that's what I want.
Thank you.
I'd be happy to address that if you'd like.
Sure.
In my experience, the price that you see at retail in a supermarket in New York City is not unlike the cost of others' products that you're paying for in New York City. There is no direct correlation. There's no regulation that mandates a lockstep price from what the farm gets to what is sold at retail. We do not set retail prices. We're the middle person. The retailers set the price, and the strategy that retailers employ there's many strategies. They have different product mix and marketing strategies. Some use them as a loss leader. Some don't. Some look at milk as a profit item, and that's a good thing. Farmers need to realize that retailers are our best friend, and that what they do has no reflection on the pricing structure at the federal level. That the price that the dairy farmers receive. We need retailers to promote our product. We need retailers to expand shelf space. We need retailers to promote and advertise, coupon, do everything that we can to sell our product. If you hold and bind the retailer's hands, they're going to look at your product and say, well, should we give it more or less shelf space? Bind my hands into the profit that I can make on that product, we'll give it less shelf space. Less shelf space directly correlates and translates into less sales. We can't justify what the retailers do or not do, but there is no correlation between what the retail price does and the at the farm level.
Thank you. Could I? This is normally how we do things, okay?
I'd be glad to talk to you after.
Yeah, I'm sure Mr. Krupke would be glad to talk to you outside, okay? Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you.
We're going to go a little out of order because Eric Ooms needs to leave. He's Vice President, Board of Directors, New York Farm Bureau, and he will be joined by Julie Suarez, Director of Public Policy. Or maybe not. Maybe it's just Eric.
Actually, Eric's just been fine.
Okay. Gotcha.
For the opportunity to be here today. It's always interesting to get the different perspectives as you sit through these hearings, and I think these hearings can be very valuable as we move forward. My name is Eric Ohms. My father, two brothers, and I milk about 400 cows in Kinderhook in Columbia County. In addition, we grow about 1,700 acres of crops, and we sell some extra crops to dairy farmers. So this year, we're really feeling, I mean, not only is our milk price off by 40%, but the people we sell feed to don't have the money to pay us either. So that's been a real challenge. And my dad, who's just turned 77 yesterday, is generally a matter of fact, you know, not a, a generally positive guy, just saying now, you know, matter of factly that this is the worst he's seen in 50 years. And as I talk to different policymakers and so forth, people talk about the state budget needing to cut X dollars. And talking to an individual last week was telling me about having to cut some money from their budget. I said, well, our budget's down 40% this year. Would you like to trade? And, of course, no one's willing to do that. In addition, I have my wife and I have two little kids. And my goal in life is that my son, who's 2 years old, just turned two, and my daughter, who's 2 weeks old, have the same opportunities that I've had to serve the dairy industry, not only as a dairy farmer who, you know, got up this morning. I overslept, so I got up at 10 after 4, and I'm going to go home and milk this afternoon. I'm also proud to represent New York Farm Bureau and our 28,000 farm family members and our 52 county farm bureaus. Just a couple of things that we view as could be real potential, just things going forward. We appreciate all your support in the past for the dairy investment money in 2007. Going forward, property taxes, that's not anything you don't know, but we need to keep a, we need to do something on that. And especially if there's gonna be more mandates coming down from the federal government, our local governments don't have any choice. I mean, they can't, they have to raise their property taxes. We're very concerned about the level of fees coming down from government, LLC fees last year, for instance. it's just making it harder and harder. You know, in the effort to not raise taxes quite as much, raising a fee is the same as raising taxes, in our opinion. As far as specifically in New York State, things we can do for the dairy industry. We need to, it would be nice if we could partner together with Pennsylvania and Vermont in some type of pricing structure. I'm glad to hear Bruce is so supportive of the dairy industry today. Perhaps maybe we could revisit that. But unfortunately, I think we're going to have to probably get federal support for that, or federal acquiescence for that. And I'll get into the federal side in just a minute. I think we also need to consider continuing to help out with local markets. We've got the biggest, most affluent consumer base in the world within a couple hundred miles of my house, whether it be the New England markets of Boston, Providence, and of course New York City. federally, we've been, New York Farm Bureau has been spending a lot of time this year pushing to have more money funneled through the MLC program, which the U.S. Senate, I believe, or the House, just passed their ag appropriations bill with $350 million. $60 million of that will go directly to purchase cheese and dairy products to be donated to food pantries and so forth. And the other $290 million will be divvied up amongst dairy farmers. We're not sure what that's going, what how that's going to be done yet, but our goal at New York Farm Bureau is to be certain that it's equitably done and to make sure that the money isn't all sucked up by other states. I often tell people I'm generally, when I come to these things, I've been the youngest person in the room for 10 or 15 years now, and I still am one of the younger people in the room, and if my goal in life is if we could decouple the way Class 1 milk is priced, drinking milk, my life would be complete. Then I can leave the stage and go home and play with my kids. Because right now, everything is driven by, you heard it referenced earlier this morning, the price of cheese in the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. And that doesn't make a whole lot of sense when you've got 2% of the milk traded in Chicago, and we're putting the price of drinking milk, whether it be in Kinderhook, New York, or in Manhattan, on it somehow, you know, it always relates to that block of cheese. And I'm hopeful there's a couple different things out there right now. I'm hopeful we can find some consensus. It's easy to say we should get off of that, but where do we go to make it better? That's the tough question, and I'm looking forward to continuing to work on that. As far as the influence of imported product coming into compete with our products, imports are not paying a promotion assessment that all U.S. dairy farmers pay. The 08 Farm Bill mandated that they pay 7.5 cents. We pay 15. That still hasn't been implemented. One of the things we're pushing our federal legislators is what's taking USDA so long to implement the rule. Secondly, it should be 15 cents. So we may have to wait till the next Farm Bill, but we need to keep that up because that's one of the things that will at least make sure they're on a level playing field with us. We are in support of Senator Schumer's MPC import bill. Again, it's kind of doing the similar types of things, making sure we're on at least, if we can't totally stop them from coming in, let's make sure that they're on a level playing field with us. We also support dairy country of origin labeling. So when you buy a dairy product, you can find out where it comes from. And back to the state level, whenever you buy a bottle of milk, you see that plant code. I have no clue which plant code is which, but I mean, wouldn't it be nice to know if that plant code, you know, could just say, you know, made at, for instance, Syracuse, New York, or wherever you have Gorelick over here in Rensselaer. I think that's something that on a state level, we should be able to find a way to, instead of having those numbers that nobody knows what they are, have a couple characters of letters that people can actually read. We also are supportive of the Department of Justice investigation into the consolidation in the dairy industry. Again, that's a deep concern for all of us and how we move forward on that. Again, it's far easier said than done to fix these problems. In addition, we cannot simply ignore export markets. That's why whenever we talk about imports, we need to make sure they're on a level playing field with us. But we can't simply discount. We currently, right now, are exporting 4 to 5% of our domestic dairy product. If we push the needle too far, then we won't be exporting that 5%. 2 years ago, we were exporting over 11-12% of our product. That's why our price got high. The challenge now is these price fluctuations have just gotten so out of control, and it's so hard for us to navigate these waters. Even if you're the best managed farm in the state, I think you'd be pretty hard pressed to find a dairy farm that's not borrowing money to get through this. And there's a lot of people that can't borrow money anymore because they've simply used up their credit. But they, as someone related earlier, they can't get out of business. I think you said it. You can't get out of business because your product's not worth anything and the rest of the economy is not any good either. So where are you going to go if you do sell your cows or give your cows away? So what we're also looking for is we're hopeful that the Secretary of Agriculture is doing a Federal Order Review Commission. We're hopeful that we'll have some good Northeast representation on that commission and that they will look at the issues facing our national industry, and we'll hope that that commission takes real serious consideration into regional differences and the need for supplies of milk in parts of the country. And I know Senator Bonasek's mentioned several times today, you know, we need to have the domestic supply of milk. And I talk about regional, but we need it in the country as well, because as soon as we chase it out, we have no more control over it. And I've heard in the, you know, not to get into the politics of the climate change debate, but there's companies that are endorsing climate change regulation, but they're doing that because they don't care, because they're production's already out of the country. So I think we need to, you know, be certain that we can keep that production here, and we still have dairy production. We still have agriculture production in this country. But as soon as we export the production, we won't have control over how it's produced. So I appreciate your time. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. And I appreciate you letting me go first. I can stay for 5 minutes, but trying to still be a dairy farm, play the role of dairy farmer as well. So thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Ooms, I appreciate your testimony very much, and you raise a very valid point regarding the state budget that was passed earlier this year. It increased taxes and fees by $8.5 billion. I agree with you that a fee is indeed a tax, and a lot of those increased taxes and fees really hit farmers hard. For example, we had the loss of the STAR rebate check, but also utility costs went up. The 18A utility tax was put into place that is passed along to consumers. Could you speak very briefly about the utility tax and how it impacts farmers, especially as they're milking their cows and their electricity costs?
Well, I would then tend to think that relatively it's going to impact farmers. It's going to impact you based on how much energy you use, and therefore it's certainly not going to help us. Now, I will say, I guess kind of I'm against taxes. That, you know, we agree fees and taxes are the same thing. We're glad that our electric bill this September is half of what it was last year because it's been such a cool summer, so we're not spending as much money to cool our cows. Having said that, any fees you pass on are just not a positive thing. And I know I talked to you earlier this year about the commuter tax or the MTA tax. And again, I'm fortunate because I live far enough north that my farm doesn't fall into it, but you got a number of people here that live in the area where they're going to be paying either a third or a quarter percent on their payroll taxes to balance the MTA's books. And again, that just doesn't seem very equitable. So I guess that would be it.
Well, you know, there are a lot of things happening in Albany that seem to be very negative to the agricultural industry, and one is the potential passing of the farm labor bill that would drive up labor costs for farmers. Could you just touch on that briefly about what you think the impact would be if that became law?
I think it would be a very bad impact on the dairy industry, and it would be a completely devastating impact on the fruit and vegetable industry. And I want to thank you and your colleagues for standing steadfastly against it. So there's opportunity when you have a couple from the other side of the aisle, we can still keep defeating that bill. And it's, you know, thanks to your support and continued support and aggressive support. And I went to the labor committee hearing, and you weren't even on the committee. You took the time to show up and just voice that this is a problem, and I appreciate that.
Thank you. Just one more question. You talked briefly about the federal program that just came through, which we so appreciate our federal representatives for drawing attention to this, and that's the $350 million. $290 million will go to dairy farmers, but that's across the entire country. And somebody was, I don't know, I haven't validated it. Somebody was telling me over the weekend that that translates into about $40 per cow or per dairy farm if you spread it across the entire country. I assume that's question one, but then I assume that you would support Senate 6140 that would provide $60 million directly into New York State dairy farmers.
First of all, it'd probably be more than $40. It's the language for the federal, the $350 million, is specific in only that it specifically says where the $60 million goes. The $290 leaves a lot of discretion to the secretary. So some people have speculated it would be the equivalent of another 1 month MILC check, would be $1.75, $1.80 per hundredweight. But that's total speculation. We have no idea how he's going to do this. And he could do it totally wrong, and it could be fairly minimal. So that's a real problem. As far as the bill to use stimulus money, we're very supportive of money that could go to the dairy farmers at any point. Our concerns over that are specifically, we haven't seen how that could happen, and we feel that the bill would need to be changed federally, and that's why we've gone the federal route on that. Having said that, I just look to our neighboring states and Vermont. We talked about a lot of states doing things for their dairy farmers, and I know that Connecticut is giving substantial money to their farmers out of the real estate transfer tax. Well, we can't do that in New York because we swept the real estate transfer tax. So the money's in there. So, but Vermont hasn't done any direct payments because they have so much milk to pay, so many dairy farmers to pay on. And that's a similar situation for Connecticut or Massachusetts to give some money to the dairy farmers. It's essentially a rounding thing, you know, in their budget because they have 100, 200 dairy farmers left. So again, Vermont has not made those payments yet. So, I mean, as soon as Vermont finds that way, I would assume we can just follow their lead. And I know that they have been working very vigorous, as you have. And so I would say I would follow their lead on this. Not that I, like, we can be the leader, but they haven't found a way to do it yet either. So,
I believe Vermont did a dairy assistance program in 2007.
They did in 2007, but they have not this year.
Yeah, okay. I think we need to do something. As you pointed out, Connecticut is doing something for the dairy farmers, and unfortunately New York State has done zero for the dairy farmers this year.
Mm-hmm.
Senator Seward, did you have any? We are joined by Senator Winner.
Thank you. Welcome, Senator Winner. Thank you.
We're glad you could make it. I know he had to juggle some things around this morning. Senator Banasek, do you have any questions?
I do not.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Okay, and thank you for letting me switch.
Thank you.